Good morning. Good morning, Mount Bethel. So glad to see you this morning. We've got announcements this morning. We've got a graduate, Adam Medcalf, graduated.
Yay! Woo!
Made it through. Yes, Adam Medcalf graduated, and next week he will be given a Bible. We got also birthdays this week. Louise Robinson, Olivia Davis is 2 years old already. Montana Webb and Ted Farmer. Happy birthday. And these ladies, y'all want to
say happy birthday? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Good job, Robbie. I heard you.
To share something with you this morning. This says, keep praying and believing. Pray without ceasing. During his lifetime, 19th century, British evangelist George Muller prayed in more than 7 million to feed orphans in his care. More than 113 million in today's terms. He didn't believe in broadcasting his financial needs, yet he always had enough to pay his grocery bill. Because God supernaturally provided. However, Muller's faith was stretched in other ways. For example, he prayed regularly over a list of 5 men he earnestly desired to see won to Christ. The first man gave his life to Christ after 5 years, the second and third after 10 years, and the fourth after 25 years. But here's the clincher. Muller prayed for the fifth man's conversion for a whopping 52 years. In fact, the man made a profession of faith in Christ a few months after Muller's funeral. Would you pray about something for 52 years without some visible sign or answer? You should and you must. In Muller's own words, God delights to increase the faith of his children. We ought, instead of wanting no trials before victory, no obstacles, difficulties, and sometimes defeats are very good of food for faith. If you're praying and asking God, will you? His answer is yes, I will. Psalm 91:15 tells us, he shall call upon me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. In Jeremiah 33:3, God says, call to me and I will answer you and show you great mighty things which you do not know. So the word for you today is keep praying. If you've got that wayward kid, if you've got that wayward situation, no matter what's going on, never quit praying, never stop believing. And we're going to go to the Lord this morning. Dear gracious God, Heavenly Father, Lord, we read about a man's faith that endured 52 years, and then a few months after he died, the fifth man was saved. We all got some situations in this parking lot that we've prayed for years and years and years and years. God, but we must not give up. Oh, imagine if Ron would have given up 6 months ago. Imagine if this situation would have given up. Imagine this marriage if they'd have quit 9 years ago or 9 months ago or 22 years ago. God, they wouldn't have had that 30th anniversary, that 40th anniversary, that 50th anniversary. We must always persevere. Lord, we love you. We praise you. We pray you help the man of God at this hour, Lord, as he tries to juggle so inconsistency, the stuff that they put out and whether to be inside or outside, or whether to do this or do that. Lord, give him godly wisdom, but most of all, let him be obedient to you, because obedience is better than sacrifice. We must not worry about a virus. We must fear not, because most of all, God, if we'll serve you, no weapon formed against us shall prosper, neither shall it come near our dwelling. We can't confess this word and just confess it. We must confess it and believe it and walk in faith that you've got us. If you be for us, who can be against us? We're more than a conqueror. You're more than able. And what you start, you'll finish. We love you. We praise you. And we welcome you, Holy Spirit, in this service to take over. And we pray everything said and done here this morning will bring you glory. And we ask you this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Amen.
First lady. Thank you. I love
thank you. sin's curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, commands my destiny. No power of God, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home.
You know, if we don't have anyone else, if we just have Christ, that's all we need. That's, he's all that we need. Thank you, Robbie, for that wonderful devotion. My ladies know my Sunday school class. I love George Mueller. Man. He is my hero in the faith. In our reader in first grade, there was always a story that I shared every year for 10 years about George Mueller and how he prayed for everything in his orphanage. And they didn't have any milk one day. They didn't have any bread one day. And little Susie, she had her cup. And this, you got to think, this is 1800s. And she said, you know, Pastor said, we're hungry. And he said, Susie, let's pray. And so they prayed. And so overnight, the milk truck broke down in front of the orphanage. And he begged George Mueller. He said, please take this milk. It's going to ruin. Please take this milk and use it for the kids.
Amen.
Right after they got the milk, then a baker said, I was up all night baking bread. And here, oh, I wanted to bring this to you. There was a knock at the door, and he brought him some bread.
Come on.
See, George Mueller never asked for anything, but he prayed about everything. He prayed about all of his needs, and all of his needs was always supplied.
Always.
And I'm just so thankful for that.
Hallelujah. Yes. Jesus, amen. Water those delicious sick beds. Water those delicious.
In and out of situations. That tug of war at me all day long, I struggle for the answers that I need. But when I come into his presence, all my questions become sacred moment, no doubt can interfere. In the presence of Jehovah, God in our hour of distress.
to everybody here, to this entire church. It took a while for me to get Jennifer into church and her dad. And first day I walked in, I knew it's where I was supposed to be. And continued to pray for her. I couldn't tell you how many nights praying. And after we started coming, we'd sit in bed and talk and sit on the couch and talk and drive in the road and talk. And I know Tony talked to her, and of course the pastor worked with her. But after about the second or third time we came, she said, "Those people up here just really act like they care. I really feel like they love me." And you don't find that everywhere. I mean, like I said, the first time I stepped in, I said, this is where I need to be. And I just wanted to say thank you to everybody. You've done, your prayers have done so much. Prayer works.
Amen.
I can't tell you how many times that he's answered my prayers, but I didn't say that last Sunday because it's just, you know, you get double dipped, you start wondering what happened, but I won't blame nobody for it. But I didn't say that last Sunday, but I definitely wanted the Lord put on my heart this morning to let each and every one of you don't realize how big of a role you play in helping somebody find the Lord.
Yes.
And I heard a song on the way to church this morning about wonder how many stars or jewels will be in my crown. It's not always just the pastor that leads somebody to the Lord. It's not always just the deacons. It's everybody that comes in here. Just your handshake or your elbow bump or just your prayers. And they do get answered, and I'm so thankful this morning. And we're just so happy to be a part of this. But I just wanted you to know that I love every single one of you. If you need anything, you call me or get in touch with me somehow. I'll be more than happy to help you. But you've done more for me and my family than you'll ever imagine. And I just wanted to say thank you. And I pray for our church and our pastor and each one of you every single night. And I'll continue to do so. I don't know the direction God's going to take me in at this point. But help me pray for that. But again, thank you. Thank you from the bottom of my heart. I love every one of you.
Kings chapter 22. An awful lot of people think they've got the solution for America today. Let me tell you something. We can't expect the world to solve this thing. We can't expect the lost man to make a right decision where it comes to the children of God. I've already spoken to some of the ladies here this morning, and it seems like the way that things are going, it's hypocrisy is what it is. Political warfare, call it whatever you want to, but we're not going to mix and mingle much with that this morning. But what we are going to do, three little words to remember this week. The Word of God, four words, the Word of God. I want that to sink in. 15 years ago, Mount Bethel had a young man here and his family, and they are our missionaries to Nepal. Jason Moon. We gave them the first $1,500, I think it was, to send them to a country that has thousands of gods. And he looked at me over lunch one day before he made the official announcement. And he said, "Preacher," he said, "Jesus Christ is just one of many thousands to them. That won't bother them a bit until it comes to putting him to the front. America needs to put Jesus back to the front today. It's that simple. Nothing else is going to answer this. Nothing else is going to solve it." Chapter 22 talks about a boy, King Josiah. Turns out to be a very good king. But I want you to listen as we read the chapter. What had taken place. Let me ask you something. Have you ever lost your personal Bible?
Yes.
I was at a Promise Keepers meeting in Memphis, Tennessee with 50,000 people and lost my Bible. Jason was just a little guy, and I was more concerned with him, and I guess I just laid it down to help him along, whatever. But amongst 50,000 people, it took me maybe 15 minutes to get to the bus, to run up to the lost and found and announce it and all this and that. And never will forget getting on that young bus, and the driver had my Bible in his hand. I couldn't believe it. Somebody had saw that Bible sitting by my seat, opened it up, saw the name, Mount Bethel Church, and got it to somebody that knew how to get it there. Now, you said you could have got another Bible. Yes, you could. But I write in my Bible. There's a lot of notes and specialties and things of that nature. But what happens when we as a society do away with the Word of God? Now, let me tell you something. There can be all kinds of good singings out there. There can be all kinds of good speakers out there. But if it doesn't lift up the name of Jesus Christ, if it doesn't glorify the Son of God, the name above all names, the only name we're given in the Bible whereby we must lift up and come before to be saved, the only name where it says, hear ye him when he was transfigured, the only name when he was baptized that God the Father said, this is my Son. And here we have a society not so much unlike ours. Now, I said something about 6 weeks ago, and I'm looking at two men that came to me after I said it. And I made this statement. And I said, I don't see America coming back just yet. And I'm not a prophet nor the son of a prophet. But I'm going to tell you what I've seen the last 6 weeks proves exactly what I said that morning. America is not praying together. America's not filling the church house up. America's not proclaiming the gospel of Jesus. Oh, yeah, there's one every now and again. Lynchburg had a good service up there the other night. But more than not, they are destroying. More than not, they are doing everything to wipe out everything that we believe. It can happen before your own eyes and you don't realize it. Now, it's a natural thing when we see protest. Peaceful protest is one thing, and I've got a personal opinion about that. I don't believe people ought to be in the street blocking me as I drive home. Peaceful or not, I just don't like it. But when it turns to vandalism, it don't need to be there. When it comes to tearing down monuments and historical items and destroying private business, I don't go for that. But now that's so obvious in our face that it's got us woke up. It's got our attention. Most of you I've spoken to today, what a shame it is in America today. Well, let me tell you about racism. Racism's not a novelty item of the United States of America. Go to the Philippines and you'll see racism. Go to Europe, you'll see racism, okay? It's not a Democrat-Republican thing. It's not a conservative-liberal thing. It's not a South versus the North thing. Racism is a hatred that dwells in the hearts of men all over this world. Amen. Now, all of this we're seeing because it's right in our face. But when we get so complacent that church is just church, or we're just going to worship because I want to worship and it's the appointed time, we're in trouble. When it gets that our society is eroding, and that's exactly what's happened, they're right amongst us. Now, let me say this, too, about my statement on COVID-19. I know the numbers are going up. And I know we said people are in the streets in town and all over here, there, and everywhere. I've not seen any of you guys. We might be safe to go inside. But you don't know who you're around that did go downtown. You see what I'm getting at? I've got to give an account before God for that. Chapter 22, a young boy is a king. Josiah was 8 years old when he began to reign. And he reigned for 31 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Jediah, and the daughter of Adaliah of Bokoth. And he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord. And he walked all in the way of David his father, and turned not aside to the right hand nor to the left.
Amen.
Praise God. And it came to pass in the 18th year of King Josiah. Now what happened with him was God put, if you read it over in Chronicles, some wise men around him. And for many years they gave him counsel. He was only 8 years old. But I'm telling you, when an heir was an heir to be king, 8 years old he became the king. But after these years of great wisdom around him, they looked over across the square and saw that the house of God was in ruins. Think about that this morning. It came to pass in the 18th year that the king said, Shaphan, the son of Azaliah, the son of Meshulam, the scribe, now realize that, a scribe to the house of the Lord, saying, go to Hilkiah, the high priest. So you've got a high priest and a scribe who should have known what the law and the word of God was. He said, go up to Hilkiah, the high priest, that he may sum the silver which is brought in the house of the Lord, which the keepers of the door have gathered to the people, and let them deliver it into the hand of the doers of the work. Now I want you to underline those three words, doers of the work. That's twice today I've miscounted. Doers of the work. Church, right now we are, as Robbie prayed and Mike said a minute ago, we are the workmen in his field.
Yes.
It's not just the words of the pastor, visitation of the pastor, or the labor of the pastor, or the deacons, or these other preachers that are here today that see people saved. It's a godly wife of a pastor or a deacon's wife. It's a Sunday school teacher. It's just a lay person, a member in the church. Somebody's watching your life. He said, go up to Hilkiah and give him the sum of the money that we've gathered and give it to those that are the doers of the work. I want to challenge you this week to be a doer of the work of God. What is our theme this year? Find me faithful to be about my Father's business. And then he said, let them deliver to the hand of the doers of the work that have the oversight of the house of the Lord. Let them give it, once again, to the doers of the work, which is in the house of the Lord, to repair the breaches of the house. Unto the carpenters, the builders, the masons, let them buy timber and hewn stone to repair the house. Now, when it says repair the house, I didn't look up the Hebrew or the Greek or anything else to see if it was saying it was to repair it or if it was to say to rebuild where it was destroyed. But something was not right down at the house of God. It's sort of like here. Once in a while, we got to put a roof on. We got to fix the gutters. We got to change out this or that or whatever in the kitchen or otherwise. But he said, let him buy timber and stone to repair the house. Howbeit, there was no reckoning made with them of the money that was delivered to their hand, because they dealt faithfully. They gave it to doers of the work who were also faithful to manage what they were doing. And then look here. This is what I want you to get. And Hilkiah, the high priest, said unto Shaphan the scribe, I have found the book of the law in the house of the Lord. That tells me if it was found, that means it was lost at this point. I want you to realize something. In America today, the precepts and the principles of the Word of God have been lost upon the hearts and the hearers of the Word of God. People have made it easy to get saved. Not bring under conviction. No, not to where you have to repent. But just come and put your name somewhere. Hilkiah said, I have found the book of the law in the house of the Lord. And Hilkiah gave the book to Shaphan, and he read it. They found it, they read it, they believed it, and they shared it. That ought to be your doers of the work this week. Found it, read it, believed it, and shared it. He said, I have found, glory to God, the book of the law in the house of the Lord. He read it, and then Shaphan said, what? And Shaphan the scribe came to the king and brought the king word again. And he said, thy servants have gathered the money that was found in the house, have delivered it to the hand of them that do the work. That's the third time. I've got to be about my Father's business.
Amen.
That do the work, that have the oversight of the house of the Lord. And Shaphan the scribe showed the king, saying, and I want you to look how he says this. Before he said he found the book of the law, he wasn't so sure. Look at what he says. He just reached it to him. Now, it's not a book like a bound Bible that you've got. It would have been parchments of some sort. But here's what it says. The scribe showed the king, saying, Hilkiah the priest hath delivered me a book. Now, many of you that know me know I like to read. And I've got several hundred books, I guess. But it says here that he gave him a book. He didn't tell him it was God's word. He didn't tell him it was the book of the law. He didn't tell him that this is who we are. The Bible says he gave him a book. Well, let me tell you about all those books I've got sitting on the bookshelves.
Oh, go ahead.
Oh, how many of you buy a book and never read it? Preacher's guilty. Oh, I'll be out book shopping and get this one and that one, and I'll find a place, a pretty place on the shelf there for it.
Yeah.
And 3 years later, I'll run over and say, well, I didn't know I had this.
Yes.
They had let the Word of God lie in a ruined place for so many years that they didn't know the principles, didn't know the precepts of God, and we've got a nation that's doing the same thing here today and don't even care about it, amen. The very ones that are being put down of society are those that are adhering to the things of God. Now, let me tell you something. There are pockets of people of every nation, every creed, every tongue, every person that's ever been born that can be mistreated. But I'm here to tell you this morning that the church is being persecuted in America today as has never been before. Amen.
Come on.
He said, I brought you a book. He gave him a book. And he said, thy servants had gathered the money that was found and delivered it. Oh, my goodness. Verse number 10. He said, they have delivered me a book. And Shapham read it before the king.
Read it.
There used to be a song they sung in this church called Dust on the Altar. There's nothing in your house that'll gather dust any quicker than the book of the Word of God laid unattended. Amen, preacher.
Amen.
You let your Bible lay there for a week or two and go to put your hands on it and see if you don't have fingerprints there. Amen.
Amen.
It shouldn't be that we need to go a day or two without the Word of God, much less a week or two.
Oh,
but dust
man.
Gets on these Bibles because we don't break into them. We don't pray over them. We don't ask the Holy Spirit of God to give us direction. We get overwhelmed because we don't understand.
Come on,
we
man.
Get overwhelmed because we've heard what man's got to say about it, and we've not even cared what God says about it. Amen. You got a young king here. 8 years old. He's had men around him for 18 years. Wise men. But not one had read him the Word of God yet. Amen. Not one. Even the scribe didn't even have the Word of God. Even the high priest didn't have the Word of God. And the king didn't have the Word of God. How can you make a godly decision if you don't have a godly foundation? Amen. You can't die right if you don't live right. Glory to God. The very best we can do. It's filthy rags. Well, I'm going to get on word here in a minute.
Go ahead.
Oh.
Do what you got to do.
Shapham read the book before the king. And it came to pass when the king heard the words of the book of the law, he rent his clothes. Oh, he got down in sackcloth and ashes.
Yes.
And it convicted him. We're afraid of that conviction because it brings us to change. Well, so-and-so said this. I said it last week or maybe the week before. Mama said I've always been saved. Mama didn't tell you right. Mama didn't give you wisdom. I've always loved the Lord. No, I'm here to tell you, you've got to be born again in the Spirit of God. Amen. The king heard the reading of the Word of God. It broke his heart. And he got down and he rent his clothes and he honored himself before God. And he, the king, commanded Hilkiah the priest, and Haakim the son of Shaphan, and Abgar the son of Micah, Liah, and Shaphan the scribe, and Ashaliah the servant of the king, saying, go ye inquire of the Lord for me, and for the people, and for all of Judah, concerning the words of the book. I want you to see something. God preserves somebody always. Huldah was a woman. Yes, God speaks through women sometimes.
Amen.
Amen. God speaks through women sometimes.
Amen.
The scribe didn't have the word. The high priest didn't have the word. But they sent him over to Huldah. Look what it says. Go ye inquire of God for me, the Lord, and for the people of Judah concerning the words of this book is found. For great is the wrath of the Lord that is kindled against us, because our fathers have not hearkened to the words of this book. And children, today, if America and all these countries of the world don't hearken to the precepts and principles of the word of this book, they're in trouble, amen.
Amen.
To do according to all that was written concerning us.
Help us,
Father. So Hilkiah the priest, and Haakim, and Abner, Shapham, and Ashaliah went to Huldah the prophetess, the wife of Shalom, the son of Tibbah, the son of Haras, the keeper of the wardrobe. Now she dwelt in Jerusalem in the college, and they communed with her. Let me tell you something. Right when you think this country's going to hell in a handbasket, God's got a little pocket of believers over here.
Yes.
God's got a little pocket of believers over here.
Yes.
God, amen. God's got a little church over here. God's going to send revival. God's got a man or woman of God somewhere. So here she was. She was in the college, it says, and they went and communed with her. And she said unto them, thus saith the Lord God of Israel. She didn't say the wise men that you've been with for 18 years. She didn't say the scribe. She didn't say the high priest. She said the Lord God of Israel. When David went before the giant, he didn't go in the name of Saul. He didn't go with the armor of Saul. He put on him the armor of God. He said, I come to you today, praise God, in the name of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God therein, amen. And God took care of that, praise God. When Moses was sent out before the people, he didn't even know who this was in the burning bush. But he said, I am that I am. He said, your father Abraham knew me. Isaac knew me. Glory to God. Jacob knew me. He knew then who he was. Joshua, when he crossed the river Jordan, he said, I come to you. Glory to God. He sent him an angel of the Lord who stood before him with a sword. And he said, I am the Lord. Glory to God. He's still God today. Amen.
Amen.
This little woman, I want to tell you something. Thus saith the Lord God of Israel. Tell the man that sent you to me. Thus saith the Lord. Behold, I will bring evil upon this place and upon the inhabitants thereof, even all the words of the book which the king of Judah hath read. Now I will tell you something. The message out of this book don't always please us.
It don't.
It whips us, as the old saying is.
Yes.
It whips us into a way that we can come before God. But God is, and let me tell you something, God is compassionate unto those that seek him. And he goes on to say, because they have forsaken me. Remember what we said in Jeremiah chapter 2 about verse number 13? He said, even the infidels of the world that have idols for gods do not give up on their gods and go somewhere else. Did y'all get that?
Right.
He said, even those of the fake worship, the worship of idols, they don't give up on their gods. And here now, you, here's what he said. He said, you have denied the living water that comes from God and dug holes in the ground. He called it cisterns that leak and cannot hold. Let me ask you something. Would you rather drink water? Kevin came to me this morning. He said, preacher, is there a bottle of water in here? He was thirsting. I said, I drunk the last one yesterday. But I said, there's water in the spigot. He said, it ain't the same. And I did too. You see what I'm getting at? Fresh water's better for you. Would you rather drink that living water that comes out from under the throne of God that Ezekiel talked about, or run off here out on the pavement, or run off out here on the ground somewhere? I'm sick and tired. Oh, Jack Hiles preached a message years ago, keep your stinking feet out of my drinking water. And what he was saying then, people come in and perverted the gospel of Jesus Christ. All these newfangled Bibles, all these new ideas, all these new thoughts that they were bringing. Josiah had all the thinking he needed for 18 years and he didn't have the Word of God. Let me tell you, how many of us have wandered down life's trail thinking we had all this training here, all this training here, all of this here, and all, and didn't have the Word of God? God help us that we can't make a right decision. But God was compassionate. For Josiah, he would give comfort. He would give pardon. He would give hope. And he'd give inspiration. For what he would say to them, they have forsaken me and burned incense to other gods, that they might provoke me to anger with all the works of their hands. Therefore my wrath shall be kindled against this place and shall not be quenched. That ain't what the king wanted to hear. But to the king of Judah, he said, but to Josiah, who sent you to inquire of the Lord, thus you may say to him, as touching the words thou hast heard. Glory to God. Because thine heart was tender, thou hast humbled thyself before the Lord. When thou heard what I spake against this place and against the inhabitants thereof, that they should become a desolation and a curse, and hast rent thy clothes and wept before me, I have also heard thee, saith the Lord. She wasn't getting this from the prophets. She wasn't getting it from the scribes. She wasn't getting it from the high priest. It says she was getting it from the Lord. Behold, therefore, I will gather thee into thy fathers, and thou shalt be gathered thy grave in peace. Thine eyes shall not see the evil which I will bring upon this place, and what they be brought the word to the king again. I want to tell you this morning, we are seeing such things happening today that if we don't get right, we might not see it in our generation, but I pray often for the generation to come. God have mercy upon me. I'm not like old Hezekiah. Study Hezekiah out. Hezekiah almost asked God, said, don't let it happen on me. He was looking out for his own flesh instead of the people he was in charge of. Go back and study Hezekiah. That was the one mistake that I see that he made that was in such great error. But let me tell you something this morning. God's still God, and there's none like him. You hear what I'm saying this morning?
Yes.
God is still God, and there's none like him. I want you to realize something today. Church, I want you to realize so clearly something today that God has got the answer for everything that we stand in need of here today. I want you to realize something today. I don't know how to say it to you as this. Is God still works with ordinary people? Second Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7 says, we have this treasure in jars of clay. That means we've got that within our own life. To show that this is all surpassing power of God that is sent through us. In other words, God said, I can use you. In the day of Gideon, they'd been encamped about for 7 years. And there was nothing going on. They were hiding from the Midianites. There was nothing they could do. But God raised up a man that was a man of valor before he realized he was a man of valor. God also gave him 300 men to drive that enemy out of there. And you know what? I don't know that the Bible gives the name of either one of those 300. God uses ordinary people. I want you to realize also that when King David was called, he was a nobody. When King Saul was called, he was a nobody. Do you see what my drift? The little boy with the two fish and the five loaves was a nobody, and we don't know his name yet. But he's taught, he's preached, amen, glory to God. He got his lunchbox together, glory to God. That mama put stuff in there that morning that was from the throne of God, and God was able to use it. But you know what we can say? We can say, we don't need you, God. That's exactly what Jeremiah was trying to tell the people in that day. Church, we cannot uphold the ways of God living any other way here in this world today. We just can't do it. We just cannot today do those things that don't please God if we don't understand that God's still in control here in America today. Whether we admit it or not, whether we want to glorify Him or not, God is still in control. Amen. God hasn't called all of us to march in the streets. And I'm going to say something you might not agree with, but I'm going to speak for myself. God hasn't called me to unify with everybody out there. Come on. He has not, a peculiar people. They're to come to God. We're not supposed to bring the world to Him. All people are created equal in the sight of God. Genesis 1:26. Do you understand that? All people have descended from Adam. The Bible says in Acts chapter 17, verse 26, we are one blood. That means God loves us all. Take it however you want to. Romans chapter 5, verse number 12 says our relationship is broken by sin. God desires, he says in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, that he would have all men come to repentance and be saved. Not black, not white, not the belugas in the Philippines, not the Aitis in the Philippines. Mike, they lived in the mountains there where you were at. They are looked at. It's a very strong racial tension. It's not an American thing. It's a man thing. We are told in Galatians chapter 3, verse 28, to proclaim the gospel to every living soul. That means to the bondsman and the free, the black, the white, the native, whoever, and let them hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. We need today, as 2 Corinthians chapter 9, 19 says, to walk in our brother's shoes just a little bit. Man, Matthew chapter 7 gives us, verse number 12, a rule that every one of us could quote, and it's called the golden rule. Let us treat others the way we like to be treated. Acts chapter 10, verse number 15, says for us to condemn racism in every fashion. Let me tell you something. We can't help others if we don't help ourselves first before the throne of God. And I'm going back. The Word of God. Let me tell you what a famous man wrote one time. And this is where I get the doers. As we express our gratitude, we must never forget that the highest appreciation is not to just utter words, but to live by them. Romans chapter 12 says, never pay back evil with evil. Do things in such a way that everyone can see your acts are honorable before God. Live in peace with everyone. Never take revenge. Leave that to God. God says, I'll revenge. I'll take revenge. If your enemies are hungry, feed them. Wait a minute, preacher. You're getting doubled up. No, I'm not. You can't feed your enemies if you've not ate at his table is what I'm trying to get to. If we are not eating at the table of God, who can prepare a table in the wilderness, in the darkness, in the valley of the shadow of death, where evil overcomes, where every enemy wants to destroy us, we can't take care of ourselves, and we can't go to the world if we've not took care of ourselves. Amen. Don't let evil conquer you, but conquer evil by doing good. Josiah, I'm going to tell you what really insulted me, one of the worst things this week. Did anybody see the picture of the Lincoln Memorial, what they've done to it? Do you folks realize, and I like history, that Abraham Lincoln was killed 1 week at the end of the war? 1 week after the end of the Civil War. This was the man who tried to emancipate, who tried to give good guidance and leadership. But there are others on the other side that didn't like it. But it gave no reason for them to desecrate. Let me give you another example out of the Word of God. May we learn from Jonah's life. I see Jonah sitting over there in the shade tree this morning. Y'all see him over there?
Yes.
See Derry? Jonah was sitting in the shade of a plant, a gourd, if you would, that he didn't even plant. But yet he was prejudiced against the people of Nineveh that God said, I've got 120,000 there that don't know the Lord, that don't know the left hand from the right hand. He's talking about little people. And there was that many more old people. But let us learn from Jonah's life that racism is sin. It keeps us from fulfilling the Great Commission. You can't help others until you get help from God. Amen.
Amen.
Let me give you this example here. So a virus, COVID-19, can go and sweep the whole nation and go global. So a protest can sweep the nation and go global. Yeah, they're protesting in England yesterday. But what about the church? Can't we go global? Huh? A protest is worthy. Yes, it is. But ain't spreading the gospel in the streets more important? Folks, if we ain't getting fed at the house of God, if we ain't taking our seat at the table of God, if we ain't preparing ourselves with the Word of God, we can't help the men of God and children of God. Amen. Is the church essential? Yes, it is. Amen. I was never so disappointed on June the 6th as I was yesterday. 76 years before, after D-Day. And we heard so little about it yesterday. They canceled so many of the celebrations. They canceled so many of the presentations. They canceled all. For have these blessed protests and riots in the street. Without D-Day, we wouldn't have America today. I don't care what side of the program you're on today. Without overcoming Germany in Normandy and France, we would not be here today. Glory to God, help us. I'll say this. For all the peaceful protesters upset about being lumped in there with the rioters, the looters, and the lawbreakers, it's kind of like the great police officers being lumped in there with a few bad ones. Think about that, church. Josiah was a boy king. And God said, you got to get your house in order. That's what the preacher's saying to you this morning. We got to get our house in order. So many of you can tell me the name of the man that started this. George Floyd. How many of you know who Chris Beatty is? How many of you know who Patrick Underwood is?
Come on.
How many of you know who Max Brewer is? How many of you know who David Dorn is? That's four policemen that have lost their lives this week.
Come on, brother.
One was a 77-year-old man, a 30-year veteran or more of the police force, that was standing guard of his own business, and they killed him.
Mercy.
We got to get our house in order. And it comes from the very Word of God.
Oh,
amen. I want you to realize something. There was a young lady this week that went down to the protest in her early 20s. You know, a lot of it curiosity. Now, I've not been downtown this week, but some of you remember when the KKK came to Asheville 30 years ago. Me and John Weaver was right there on the Vance Square, and they come in, and all the snipers were on the roof, and the SWAT. We were scared. It got to be more than what we thought it was. Many of you were downtown when the Pride marches started, and they were warring with the churches and stuff downtown. Me and Pam were there, and it got very dangerous in the city of Asheville. Oh, my goodness. Curiosity sometimes will take us places we shouldn't be. Well, this little woman, 24 years old, went out with her friends. Don't even know what city she was in. She saw it was getting dangerous. And she said, come on, friend, let's get out of here. The news media says she got in her car in the back seat and someone was to drive off and a stray shot hit her in the back and killed her. Now, I'm not going to get into this guy's character. You read that yourself. You can't martyr just anybody. Yeah, you can make a martyr of anything, but it don't glorify God.
Amen.
Man should have never died the way that he did. Now, let me touch on the other side. That should have never happened. The 75-year-old man in Buffalo should have never been knocked down. The little lady that was in the street, the cops that came along and clubbed her, should have never happened. Folks, there's learning on both sides. What I'm going to say in closing is the Word of God and His Spirit is available to whosoever will call on it this morning. Amen. There's right and wrong on each, but just because a few bad apples here, all protesters aren't rioters. Just because there's a bad cop or two here, don't mean all cops are bad cops. Amen?
Amen.
Let's say the same thing about the Christian this morning.
Yes.
Just because we all say we're Christian, does that mean we're on fire for God?
God.
This week, four little words, the Word of God. King O Josiah had men around him for 18 years. They taught him all the precepts of government, probably farming, probably trade, warfare, and everything. But they didn't have the law and the Word of God. Think about that. Not even the high priest, Hilkiah, not even the scribe, Shaphan, knew about the Word of God. They just happened to see that the house of God was in ruins. They sent money down there to build it back. And the Bible says he found the law, the book of God. I would hope this morning, as we go to close, if you're lost here this morning, if you don't know Jesus Christ, that you might allow the Spirit of God to speak to your heart. If you're not as warm to the things of God as you've ever been in your Christian life, why aren't you?
Come on.
Like these people, they had training and teaching on everything except the Word of God. But let me tell you about the Word of God. It does not change. It's forever settled in heaven. Not one jot or tittle will change, he said. He said, my name is, he said, I am God and I change not. Amen? Think about that. It's the same today, yesterday, and forevermore.
Yes, brother.
So is sin. Oh, it may have a different name. We didn't even know what the internet was 40 years ago. But look, what's good and what's evil there. Whew, my goodness. There's things going on today. I was sitting up here talking to Kevin or somebody here, and this phone went to talking back to me, and I had it turned off. Oh, it was Terry. He said, preacher, your phone's talking again. I don't know all the bells and whistles to this. I don't know all the bells and whistles to this, but I know Jesus Christ is Lord. There's no other way. There's no other name under heaven given to men that we might be saved. Amen.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to pray here. And church, I want you this week to covenant with you and God, the Word of God. I was so blessed last week when Miss Pam came out and had those quarterlies, and people was running to her. Tony had done it come to me and said, "Preacher, the quarters changed. Where's my quarterly?" He wanted his book. He wanted something to study by. And then others said, "Can I have one? Can I have one?" Don't let them go home and lay them down somewhere and gather the dust. Amen? Open them. Tear them open. Study them. Meditate over. Pray over them. You can be so trained in the things of the world and die and go to hell without Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray this morning. Before we pray, next Sunday at 10:30. Next Sunday at 10:30. We'll be in out, meaning we'll have the service here. We'll hand out the food there. Some will eat inside. Some can eat out. The next week, if things are going like they're still going and not got worse, we'll be going back in. We'll have a presentation of it outside or in the fellowship hall. We've not decided yet, depending on how many families don't want to go into the sanctuary. But invite people to come to church. Invite people of our family, of our church that you've not seen. And I know some's got little ones who can't sit in a car for an hour, hour and a half of time. And some of them can't come and sit in the heat. Or let me tell you about some, though. Sometimes it's too cold. You realize the very first service we had here, it was 34 degrees and raining, amen.
Amen.
But we had church. It's 82 degrees today and it's warm, but we're having church, amen. If you look at the weather and you look at what men want to say to you and going here and going there, glory to God, you'll find an excuse not to be at the house of God. But let me tell you something. You're finding time to go to the lake. You're finding time to go down to the beach. You're finding time for everything else. We better find time for God. There's nothing wrong with NASCAR. There's nothing wrong with a trip to the lake or to the beach. But when you'd rather do that than come to the house of God until something happens and then you call the preacher, "God help me, preacher." I still want you to call. And I'm going to answer that call. It's when other things become our first nature. And yet I chose more carefully. We always say second nature, don't we, Robbie? Because we say this is who we are and our second nature is this. But when it becomes your first nature, and it's not your desire to be at the house of God, it's not your desire to be praying, it's not your desire to be in the Word of God, glory to God. I'm telling you, He can send revival again. I'm excited. Let me tell you why I'm excited. There's opportunity to preach. There's opportunity to witness. There's opportunity to invite people to the house of God. Amen. There's opportunity to say, "Thus saith the Lord." There's a man down in the holler that's here to preach every Sunday.
Yeah.
I've been witnessing to him for the last 2 years. I keep saying, "Come on up here." There's people right down here that don't go nowhere. Who knows? God may be speaking to some. I got blessed yesterday. Dennis Ponder come over here. And let me tell you, he is scared of COVID-19. I went out the front door, and he was parked right over here, getting in his little white car, had the lid up. He put flyers on the grave. I went out the door, and maybe he thought I was making a run toward him. He said, "No, preacher, no." He threw his hands up like this. "We can't do that today." He said, "I know. I want to give you a hug, too." This will also pass, church. There'll be a time that this passes. But you know what he looked at me and said? He said, "I've been watching you on the internet." I went up to my daddy's the other day and he said, "Been watching you on the internet. Watching your church service." So there's a purpose for this, folks. Whether it's the neighbors down here or the neighbors down here or out this way, maybe out this way. But even putting it out there on the internet, I had a lot of people say, "I've watched this." Had people come say, "Boy, I enjoyed that message or this message or something." I'm not looking for praise or applause. That's not what I'm about. I say I'm the least that God's ever called. But I want to tell you something. We serve a mighty God. We serve a God, Terry, that brought us out from under a rock, don't we? Brought us from out under a rock. Whew. I'm nothing, but I am what I am by the grace of God. This morning, if you don't know Jesus, church, I want you to pray for America this week. I want you to pray for our families. Won't you pray for me? Sometimes I've got a hateful spirit to me and I don't even realize it. How do you know? Well, my wife told me. Now, wait a minute. I'm going to say that in a good way. If the wife don't tell you, you don't want your neighbor to tell you, right? Hey, the part of having a godly wife is being honest with you.
Amen.
Huh? She can set her man up on a pedestal if she wants to, but ain't that right, Kevin?
Amen.
I'm not trying to be smart. What I'm trying to say is we are who we are. And if those that love us can't tell us who we are, don't want the rest of people to do it.
All broken.
Come on. Because she's supposed to love me more than any, right?
All broken.
Oh, come on. He was talking there a minute ago about being married 9 months, 9 years. How about 41 years this year? She needs a star. She needs a crown.
Amen.
I deserve something.
Amen.
I just don't know what it is. Church, I don't care how far you've gone, what you've got into, you can make your way home. Lord, I'm coming home. There's families in this congregation today that need help, that need prayer. I want you to name your church. I want you to do what I do. I want you to go in there in your mind and look and see where people sit. Say, I'm praying for Brother Robbie and Berlin. That's who the first two are over there. Get back here at Miss Angie and Ann and Cindy. Get back here at Ray and Louise. Get back here with Ted. Get back here, Miss Arlene. You can see it yourself. You know where these people are sitting. Just pray for the church. Amen. Pray for these new folks. Praise God. I'm going to pray. Lord, we love you. We thank you. We just glorify you this morning. Very simply, all I want to say this morning is the word of God. We had a young king that for some reason, they found the word of God. He was being taught all the principles and precepts of being a king, but knew nothing of being a godly king. You may have been taught the very best in your field of what you're doing as a man, but how much more would that mean today if you were a godly man, a godly woman, a godly family? Lord, help us and realize that without you we're nothing, but with you all things are possible. Amen? All things are possible. If you're here this morning, and I can't see into too many of these cars, I'm going to do something I've not done out here yet. If you're here this morning, just bow your head. I don't want nobody looking around. And I can't see it maybe, but God will. If you're here this morning and you want to know Jesus Christ as your Savior, you sort of want me to pray for you. Just raise your hand right now. Raise your hand before God and say, Lord, I need you this morning. Could you say that this morning?
Could you just raise your hand where you're at and say, Lord, remember me.
God, I love you and I praise you. And I'm praying for families to minister to these. To these this morning that aren't sure of their salvation. No greater gift can be bestowed upon a man than to know that his name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. That he's been forgiven. He's been made whole. God help us where we fail. Strengthen us for the work before us. Lord, we pray, bless Fields of Grace as they come next week. Bless our church. Lord, let each one of us invite family and others to come and be with us. We'll do our very best of COVID-19 and spacing and all this that we're supposed to do and mask and whatever. Oh, Lord, wouldn't it be something to see someone saved?
Yes.
Wouldn't it be something to be able to go back down to the river? One lady told me this morning, said, Preacher, can you do that again? Said, I hadn't been to the river to see a baptizing since I was 10 years old. We had a wonderful time down there. We almost lost one, but God gave him back to us. The river was hard and strong. Amen. He's here with us today. Lord, I love you and I praise you. I give you honor and glory. It's in your name I do ask these things. Amen and amen. God bless each one. It's our prayer.